Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Sam Simpson. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial-A-Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your question. Sam, what day is it?
It's Wednesday.
And you know it's time for our brain teaser.
This person was an inventor of major technology. He only attended public school for 12 weeks before his mother decided to homeschool him. He quickly showed an appetite for knowledge and read books on a wide range of subjects. He contracted scarlet fever and battled several ear infections at a young age, which eventually left him nearly deaf. When he was 12, he set out on his first entrepreneurial venture by selling newspapers that he wrote and sold along a railroad. In 1870, he decided to set up his first small lab in Newark, New Jersey.
17 years later, he moved to West Orange, New Jersey, where he built a large industrial research lab. This person is best known for the invention of the light bulb and the phonograph. He recorded the first words on a piece of tin foil. This person also invented the telegraph, alkaline batteries, and the quintophone, a camera for motion pictures. He eventually came to hold over 1,000 patents for his inventions. This famous inventor died at the age of 84 in West Orange, New Jersey in 1931.
So if you think you can solve the brain teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Every correct response we add it to our Hotline Hall of Fame, earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season, which is coming up really soon. This is the last week you can earn points toward the tablet. Our winners will be announced the last week of April.
Cool.
Ready to do some homework?
Yes, I am.
All right. Hi.
Hello?
Who's this?
Carlos.
Hi,
hey, Carlos.
Hey, Carlos.
I think we've got your problem on the board. Let's go take a look and see if we can work that for you.
Okay.
Make sure I'm doing this correct, or I have the problem correct. A group of students attending a math club. Half of the students are boys, and 4/9 of the boys have brown eyes. What fraction of the group of boys have brown eyes? Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. So what I attempted to do is to make a little rectangle here, and if half of the group are boys, the other half have to be girls. All right, now we need to figure out, so half of these we're not that concerned about. We only are concerned about the half that are boys. And then it says, of these boys, 4/9 of them have brown eyes. So I need to make, if I'm gonna do it this way, I need to make, oh, let's see if I can do this. 1/9, 2/9, 3/9, 4/9, 5/9, 6/9, 7/9, of course, 8/9. Those are supposed to be knives, so bear with me. Those are supposed to be knives. Of those, 4/9 of them have brown eyes. How many? 1, 2, 3, 4. Those all have brown eyes. Now we can kind of get to the question that they're asking us for. What fraction of the group of boys have brown eyes? Do you have any idea how we can figure that out from here?
No.
All right. So if I had this actually my rectangle drawn correctly, if this whole half is the same as this half, if I have 9 rectangles on the top, I have to have 9 rectangles on the bottom. So I would have a total of, in other words, how many of these do I have? 9 on the top plus 9 on the bottom gives me a total of 18. How many of them have brown eyes? 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's our answer. 4 out of 18. Wait a minute, though, before we settle on that. That's a fraction. Can we reduce that fraction? Yes.
Yes.
What number will go into 4 and into 18?
2.
Yep. So I'm going to divide the numerator by 2 and the denominator by 2. 4 divided by 2 is?
2.
2. 18 divided by 2 is? I'm helping you out there. 9. So our answer is 2/9. Now, depending on what grade you're in, there are other ways we could solve this. One way we could solve this is actually just take our 4/9 and multiply it by 1/2, and we would get 4 over 18, which we could reduce to 2/9. This is a great problem that you might see on an exam somewhere, so this is one to study. Hope this helped you. Thanks for calling in, Carlos.
Okay. Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
That was cool, Sam. Showing him a couple different tools to put in his toolbox to solve those problems. All right, we had an email sent into us that I'm going to go over and address at the board right now.
Cool.
All right. So this student emailed us, and they wanted to know, how is erosion and weathering similar? So I pulled up a couple pictures. Here we have a picture of a glacier, and then we have a cross-section or a part of the cross-section of the Earth showing some water and around. And ultimately, when you come to these words, and they are vocabulary words, it's about science, and I teach my students that science is like learning another language, right? And unless you're a nerd or a geek like I am, you don't really talk about these kind of terms around the kitchen table, all right? So it's really important that you spend some time outside of school studying these things, all right? So erosion, we got to say, what is erosion all about? And erosion is the breaking, or is the moving of soil from one place to another, all right? So we're moving, we're going to move soil, and that soil can be rocks, it can be dirt, it can be all kinds of little pieces of debris. All right, we're moving soil from one place to another. All right, now that can happen because of, if we have a glacier, this is a big, thick layer of ice, and in New York State, Rochester, during the last ice age about 10,000 years ago, was covered with a mile thick of ice. Imagine that. So all of the pressure down here that would move all these little bits of dirt, little bits of, and actually rocks probably as big as a car, would get pushed along, and they would gouge the ground out, and they would move and move and move as that glacier moved. So that's what erosion is. You're moving soil from one place to another. It can happen because of blowing wind or moving water at the ocean or the shoreline, the tides coming in and out, it'll happen that. What is weathering, all right? Weathering is the wearing away. The wearing away of rock or soil, all right? So now here's where you can see where they're kind of very similar. If erosion is the moving of soil from place to place, and weathering is the wearing away of soil or rock, they kind of happen by the same way. Weathering can happen two ways. You can have a physical weathering where you actually just change the shape or size of the rock. Take a big rock, you throw it on the ground, it breaks in half. It's the same kind of rock, which is physical weathering. Another kind of weathering you can have is called chemical weathering. This is where the rock reacts with something in the atmosphere or acid rain falling from the sky, causing it to dissolve and change composition. You might see chemical weathering happening in a cemetery with some of the old limestone headstones that are in there. Some of them you can't read the words anymore because they have been worn away by chemical erosion or chemical weathering that happens on the surface of the rock. So they're very, very similar. Erosion is the moving of soil from one place to another, and weathering is the wearing it away. All right, so you got to wear the rocks away, then you move it to a new place, you get sedimentary going on. If it gets really hot, you might have metamorphic, or you might have igneous if it melts and becomes magma and gets put back out into the surface again. So I hope that helps you get a little bit of understanding. And again, science is a lot of vocabulary. Thanks a lot.
How do you know which century you live in? 21st century equals 2000s. 20th century equals 1900s. 19th century equals 1800s. 18th century equals 1700s. And 17th century equals 1600s. And so on.
Tonight on Homework Hotline, we take a closer look at Nikola Tesla and wireless energy. Take a look.
IE questions, your energy questions answered. This question comes to us from several people. Why don't we have wireless energy? Well, we do actually have wireless energy, but it's not everywhere. To understand why, let's go back to the 1890s and an inventor named Nikola Tesla. He was an early pioneer of radio, x-rays, and of course, electricity. Tesla had an idea. Rather than sending electricity through wires, we could send it through the Earth. If the electric current matched the Earth's resonant frequency, the Earth would act as a conductor, essentially a giant global wire. Using a receiver, people could pick up electricity anywhere around the world. No wires, no cables, and virtually no energy would be lost. So Tesla ran experiments at his lab in Colorado Springs, sending electricity from the lab to light bulbs hundreds of feet away. Tesla dreamed that radio signals, telegraph messages, even pictures could travel this way. But to really test this theory, Tesla needed to think bigger. So he started building Wardenclyffe Tower on Long Island in 1901. The 17-story tower would have sent electricity from a coal-powered generator deep into the ground via 300 feet of metal rods, where it would travel hundreds of miles through the Earth's crust. But Tesla never got to test it. He couldn't raise the money and went bankrupt. By 1917, the tower was torn down and sold for scrap, and our country grew its electric grid with a vast network of wires. Tesla's vision of worldwide wireless electricity hasn't materialized. But we do have wireless power. A process called magnetic induction has powered electronics without wires since Tesla's day. But until a few years ago, this tech was only viable over very short distances. Think an electric toothbrush in its holder, or electric buses rolling up to a parking spot to get some juice. Recent breakthroughs in resonant magnetic coupling let us send electricity efficiently inches or even feet. So now you can charge your phone while it's still in your pocket or a medical device inside your body. But Tesla's dream of truly long-range wireless electricity is still alive. Japan's space agency is developing a solar satellite that would beam power back to Earth with microwaves. Their goal for completing the first orbiting solar power plant? 2031. Just in time for Tesla's 175th birthday.
Wow. That's cool. I think with all the technology stuff that we carry, you know, and the batteries where you don't have to plug them in, that kind of induction charging would be, it's coming and it's getting better.
Well, wireless power, what's possible then?
Yeah.
And it's possible now.
Right.
It's just a matter of, do we have the will and desire to invest in that kind of technology,
yes.
And explore it.
Yep.
If you would like to see this video again or others like it, head to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos. Craig, we had some questions about the last problem that I worked on the board with Carlos. I'm going to come over to the board, and why don't you come on over with me, and let's talk about it a little bit.
Cool.
Because a lot of these kind of questions are how you interpret what they're asking you to do.
Right.
And that's a big challenge, particularly with Common Core.
Because a lot of it is word problems. You got to pull what the information is and then answer the question.
Correct.
Right.
So let's just take a look at it again. A group of students attending a math club, half of the students are boys.
Which we got here, boys and girls, that's half.
And 4/9 of the boys have brown eyes.
And you did a really good job of almost getting those nines, right?
So of this nine,
we have four.
Four of them have brown eyes. Then they ask us, what fraction of the group have brown eyes? They're not just asking about, or are they? Boys.
Right, and here's where you have to go, and it says what fraction, and you stop at group, but it says group of boys have brown eyes.
So if you looked at boys, it's just 4 out of 9.
Right.
But if you want the what group, what percentage, or
what fraction
out of all of them,
right.
Well, all of them, there are 18 squares here, and it's 4 out of 18. A lot of that, which we could reduce down to 2/9.
Right, but if they're just asking the group of boys, then I would say that you got to go with 4 out of 9 because it's not saying out of the group of students.
Right,
right.
These kind of problems, I'm glad you called in, caller. These are the kind of things that you have to think about.
Yes.
Because if you just rush through a problem, you could get it wrong.
Like we did.
Again, I am taking a question that someone sent in to us. So I'm assuming that it was given to us right. So those are kind of things you want to think about.
Now, this is another point also where we've also instruct our students that if you don't understand, come back and ask your teacher, all right? Because then they're going to clarify, well, okay, this is what I'm asking you to do, all right?
Great problem, though. We like that, and we like you to call back in. Thank you.
Having trouble remembering the number of days in each month? Think of this saying, 30 days hath September, April, June, and November. All the rest have 31, except February alone, which hath but 28, and fine, till leap year gives it 29.
Very good. We got another problem that we didn't get to yesterday.
All right.
That someone called in. Actually, a grandmother. Thanks, Grandmom. Please call in with problems. We love you, too. I'm going to go over the board, and we'll take a look at that.
All right.
Grandma might have been talking about Peter here. Peter had to write a 10-page paper in 3 days. That's a lot of writing. The first day, he wrote 3.5 pages. The second day, and I have a typo here, he wrote 4 and not 1/2, but 4 and 1/3, okay? Pages. How many pages does he have to write on the third day? Well, we know that all of it has to add up to 10 pages. So when I look at this problem, there are lots of ways you can do these kind of problems. I know that I have 3 fractions that have to add up to 10. I have 3.5 plus 4 1/3, and what he has to do on that third page, we'll put a question mark, but all has to add up to 10. So when you get to high school and you get to algebra, we replace the question marks with variables, and we use our favorite one, x. So now, what do I want to do here? I want to add this left-hand side up. What I really want to do is, in order for me to do that, I have mixed numbers there. There are a lot of ways I can do it. But I think what I'm going to need to do first is get common denominators. I have 1/2, and I'm not going to even mess with the threes. But I have 1/2, and I have 1/3. If I want to get a common denominator between 1/2 and 1/3, my common denominator in this case is going to be 6/1/6, or my denominator is going to be 6, so what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to have to change the 1/2 to some percentage of 6, or some fraction with 6 in it. What I'm going to do is, and the way we get common denominators like this, is I say, what do I have to multiply 2 by to get 6? I have to multiply that by 3. 2 times 3 will give me 6. And if I do it on the denominator, I got to also do it in the numerator. What do I multiply? When I multiply 1 by 3, I get 3. So 1 half is equal to 3 sixths. So I'm going to write, instead of 1 half, I'm going to write 3 sixths. I'm going to do the same process with the 1 third. 1 third, and again, I want to get 6 in the denominator. So what am I going to multiply 3 by? I'm going to multiply it by 2. 3 times 2 gives me 6. And whatever I multiply my denominator by, I got to multiply my numerator by. 1 times 2 is 2. So my 1 third becomes 2 sixths. Plus something is going to be equal to 10. But now that I have a common denominator here, I can add these two fractions together pretty simply. 3 and 4 is 7. Now, when these are the same, I'm just going to add, I'm going to do it vertically, and then we'll come back to this. Because it's easier for, I think, for students to see it when I do it this way. 3 plus 4 is 7. These are 6s. How many of them do I have? 3 plus 2 is 5. So when I add these two together, I get 7 and 5 sixths. So now I have 7 and 5 sixths plus something is equal to 10. Now the way I find that something is, I'm going to subtract this from both sides. If I subtract 7 and 5 sixths from this side and 7 and 5 sixths from this side, what happens on my left-hand side, those cancel out. 7 and 5 sixths minus 7 and 5 sixths cancel each other out, and I get x on that one side. So now what I want to do is I want to take 10 and I want to subtract from it 7 and 5 sixths. But what I need to do is I need to change this 10 to a 9 because I'm going to borrow a whole one. The whole one is actually going to be 6 over 6. 9 and 6 over the 6 is the same as 10. So 9, 7 from 9 gives me 2, and 6 or 5 from 6 gives me 1. My answer ends up being, in that last day, he's got to write 2 and 1/6 of a page to make sure he gets all 10 pages done and grandmom is happy. Great question. Thanks for calling in.
Did you know that not only is Australia one of the largest countries on Earth, but it's also the only country that covers an entire continent? Australia also has a lot of natural resources and fertile land. Not bad for a country that is one-third desert. Australia is known for its outback, which contains the country's largest deserts and is known for its sweltering temperatures, little water, and almost no vegetation. Since Australia is a large island, there are many animals that can only be found here and nowhere else in the world, such as the platypus, kangaroo, and the echidna. Not only is Australia home to the cute and cuddly, like the koala, but also some of the deadliest snakes and spiders on the planet. There are over 500 national parks in Australia to make sure these rare plants and animals are protected. Australia is home to the world's largest collection of coral reefs called the Great Barrier Reef. The whole Great Barrier Reef area, about 348,000 square miles, is protected as a World Heritage Site.
All right, we have Ymir, our winner in tonight's Brain Teaser. Hi, Ymir.
Hi.
All right,
congratulations. What gave it away? What helped you? Well, first of all, who is the answer to our Brain Teaser?
The answer is Thomas Alva Edison.
All right.
Very good.
Excellent.
How did you, what gave it away? What clue did we give that helped you decide that that was the answer?
When you said that he was the inventor of the light bulb and the photograph.
Yeah. Cool.
So is there anything else that you might know about Thomas Edison that you could tell and share with the rest of our viewers? Put you on the spot there.
Well,
go ahead.
No, 1,000 patents is really, really a big deal.
Or only going to school for 12 weeks,
yeah,
and then going out and doing that 1,000 pens.
Wow, and that's a big thing. And I actually go to Edison high school here, and or I teach at Edison High School here in Rochester, so that's pretty cool too.
Right. And he was homeschooled, don't forget, too, so parents had a big role in that.
Big role.
All right, congratulations. Don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you, like Ymir, could win a tablet at the end of the season, which is coming up real soon.
Real soon. That's all that we have time for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Tyler teachers available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, friends from the Rochester Museum and Science Center are going to be here. Good night.
Bye, guys.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.